Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Gopi Janna Valabha Girivara Dari. Gopi Janna Valabha Girivara Dari. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janna Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Braja Janna Ranjana. Jamuna Tira Vannachari. Yamuna Tira Vannachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jam Vishnu Pad Padmahamsa Vajrajik Charya Asto Tadasita Shushimad. His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jayam Vishnupad Padamahamsa Padavajakacharya Asto Tadasata Shishimad Sringa Guru Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaj Kijai Ananti Koti Vaishnavinda Kijai ISKCON BBT Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Kijai Namacharya Srila Haridas Thakur Kijai Premsikaho Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nitya Ananda Sri Advaita Garadhara Srivasari Gaur Bhaktavinda Kijai Shri Shri Radha Krishna, Gopi Gopinath, Shyamakund Radhakund, Giri Govardhan Ki Jai. Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai, Mayapur Dham Ki Jai, Navadvip Dham Ki Jai, Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai, New Dwarka Dham Ki Jai, Jamunamaya Gangamaya Ki Jai, Tosi Devi Bhakti Devi Ki Jai, Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Harinam Sankirtan Jagya Ki Jai, Prasadam Distribution Ki Jai, Book Distribution Ki Jai, Their Divine Lordship, Sri Sri Rukmini Dwarkadish Ki Jai. Their Divine Lordship, Sri Sri Jagannath Baladev Shimate Subhadra Ki Jai. Their Divine Lordship, Sri Sri Gornitai Ki Jai. Gaur Premananda Hare Haribo. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories to all the assembled devotees, Hare Krishna. All glories to Sri Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Glories to Srila Prabhupada. Namo Mishundaya Krishna Staya Bhutale Smriti Jayatak Swamini Tamini Namo Mishundaya Krishna Staya Bhutale Smriti Bhakti Vyana Swamini Tamini Namaste Sarasvati Devi Guru Pacharya Namaste Sunvaiti Pashtati Staya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So today we're reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam. This is the ninth canto, chapter 4, text 2 to 17. So there's a lot of verses without purports. So I'm going to read all of them, and then we'll chant the last verse, text 17, together, even though the one before that has the purport. Number 17 relates. So today, let's discuss a little bit about what it means to be most fortunate. And we're going to see who is the most fortunate and how we can become most fortunate. So let's dive right into the reading of the text. So Nabaga inquired, "My dear brothers, what have you given to me as my share of our father's property?" His elder brothers answered, "We have kept our father as your share." But when Nabaga went to his father and said, "My dear father, my elder brothers have given you as my share of property," the father replied, "My dear son, do not rely upon their cheating words. I am not your property." Text number 3. Nabaga's father said, "All the descendants of Angira are now going to perform a great sacrifice. But although they are very intelligent, on every sixth day, they will be bewildered in performing sacrifice and will make mistakes in their daily duties." Nabaga's father continued, "Go to those great souls and describe two Vedic hymns pertaining to Vasudeva. When the great sages have completed the sacrifice and are going to the heavenly planets, they will give you the remnants of the money they have received from the sacrifice. Therefore, go there immediately." Thus, Nabaga acted exactly according to the advice of his father, and the great sages of the Angira dynasty gave him all their wealth and then went to the heavenly planets. Thereafter, while Nabaga was accepting the riches, a black-looking person from the north came to him and said, "All the wealth from the sacrifice arena belongs to me." Nabaga then said, "These riches belong to me. The great saintly persons have delivered them to me." When Nabaga said this, the black-looking person replied, "Let us go to your father and ask him to settle this disagreement." In accordance with this, Nabaga inquired from his father. The father of Nabaga said, "Whatever the great sages sacrificed in the arena of the Daksha Yajna, they offered to Lord Shiva as his share. Therefore, everything in the sacrificial arena certainly belongs to Lord Shiva." Thereupon, after offering obeisances to Lord Shiva, Nabaga said, "O worshipable Lord, everything in this arena of sacrifice is yours. This is the assertion of my father. Now, with great respect, I bow my head before you, begging your mercy." Lord Shiva said, "Whatever your father has said is the truth, and you are also speaking the same truth. Therefore, I, who know the Vedic mantras, shall explain transcendental knowledge to you." Lord Shiva said, "Now you may take all the wealth remaining from the sacrifice, for I give it to you." After saying this, Lord Shiva, who is the most adherent to the religious principles, disappeared from that place. So if one hears and chants or remembers this narration in the morning and evening with great attention, he certainly becomes learned, experienced in understanding the Vedic hymns, and expert in self-realization. So just see, if I sit in here today, we're becoming all these things. If one hears and chants or remembers this narration in the morning and evening with great attention, he certainly becomes learned, experienced in understanding the Vedic hymns, and expert in self-realization. So from Nabaga, Maharaj Ambarish took birth. Maharaj Ambarish was an exalted devotee, celebrated for his great merits. Although he was cursed by the infallible Brahmana, the curse could not touch him. King Pariksit inquired, "O great personality, Maharaj Ambarish was certainly most exalted and meritorious in character. I wish to hear about him. How surprising it is that the curse of a Brahmana, which is insurmountable, could not act upon him." So go to this is texts 15 and 16. So Sukadeva Goswami said, "Maharaj Ambarish, the most fortunate personality, achieved the role of the entire world, the rule of the entire world, consisting of seven islands, and achieved inexhaustible, unlimited opulence and prosperity on earth. Although such a position is rarely obtained, Maharaj Ambarish did not care for it at all, for he knew very well that all such opulence is material. Like that which is imagined in a dream, such opulence will ultimately be destroyed. The king knew that any non-devotee who attains such opulence merges increasingly into material nature's mode of darkness." So there's a purport for this particular verse. It's short. For a devotee, material opulence is insignificant, whereas for a non-devotee, material opulence is the cause of increasing bondage, for a devotee knows that anything material is temporary, whereas a non-devotee regards the temporary so-called happiness as everything and forgets the path of self-realization. Thus, for the non-devotee, material opulence is a disqualification for spiritual advancement. Okay, so today's verse. Vasudevi Bhagavati Tad Bhakteshu Cha Sadushu Prapto Bhavam Param Vishvam Inedam Lostravat Smritam Vasudevi Bhagavati Tad Bhakteshu Cha Sadushu Prapto Bhavam Param Vishvam Inedam Lostravat Smritam Vasudevi Bhagavati Tad Bhakteshu Cha Sadushu Prapto Bhavam Param Vishvam Inedam Lostravat Smritam Sudeve Bhagavati Asvitam Sudeve Bhagavati Sudeve Bhagavati Bhakteshu Sadhu Vasudeve Bhagavati Tad Bhakteshu Cha Sadhusu Prapto Bhavam Param Vishvam Inidam Lostravat Smritam Vasudeve Bhagavati Tad Bhakteshu Cha Sadhusu Prapto Bhavam Param Vishvam Inidam Lostravat Smritam Vaishnavis Vasudevi Bhagavati Bhakteshu Sadeshu Bhaktavara Mama Bishwam Nilosnam Sumasmitam Vasudevi Bhagavati Pakto Bhavam Padam Vishwam and Dandam of Tundasam Sam Vasudeve unto the all pervading Supreme Personality Bhagavati unto the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Tat Bhakteshu unto his devotees. Cha also. Sadhusu unto the saintly persons. Praptaha one who has achieved. Bhavam reverence and devotion. Param transcendental. Vishvam, the whole material universe. Yena, by which? Spiritual consciousness. Idam, this. Lostravat, as insignificant as a piece of stone. Smritam, is accepted by such devotees. Maharaj Ambarish was a great devotee of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudev, and the Lord and the saintly persons who are the Lord's devotees. Because of this devotion, he thought of the entire universe as being as insignificant as a piece of stone. Let's repeat this one. Maharaj Ambarish was a great devotee of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudev, and of all the saintly persons who are the Lord's devotees. Because of this devotion, he thought of the entire universe as being as insignificant as a piece of stone. Om Gyana Timarandasya Gyananjana Salakaya Chakshus Unli Tamina Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitamena Bhutale Swayam Upadamayam Didanti Swabhadantikam Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Garadhara Shiva Sari Gaura Bhakta Vinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Vancha Kopa Tubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhivacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha. So I'll just repeat the last two verses, translations, here. So for a devotee, this is actually the purport, which is pretty small. But let's just go back here. Sudha Goswami said, Maharaj Ambarish, the most fortunate personality, achieved the rule of the entire world, consisting of seven islands, and achieved inexhaustible, unlimited opulence and prosperity on earth. Although such a position is rarely obtained, Maharaj Ambarish did not care for it at all, for he knew very well that all such opulence is material. Like that which is imagined in a dream, such opulence will ultimately be destroyed. The king knew that any non-devotee who attains such opulence merges increasingly into material nature's mode of darkness. Maharaj Ambarish was a great devotee of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vasudev, and of the saintly persons who are the Lord's devotees. Because of this devotion, he thought of the entire universe as being as insignificant as a piece of stone. So this is very interesting. On one hand here, we have a great devotee, Maharaj Parikshit, who is a great king and is inquiring from Sukadeva Goswami, who himself is probably the most renounced person. I mean, look at him. He doesn't even have one thread of cloth. He was living on one cup of milk a day. He was the perfect brahmachari from birth. He completely was self-realized, and he left home. He ran away as soon as he was born because he didn't want to be covered by Maya. But yet here, he's praising a person who we're describing in this particular chapter and several chapters as someone who is most fortunate, most opulent and exalted. I mean, he has a great personality, has great opulences, has everything he wants. He's a great king, but yet this most renowned person is glorifying him. And we wonder why. And we'll see that great personalities, what makes them great is that they see everything in the universe as Krishna's, and they use it for Krishna. Otherwise, it's no more important than a stone. They consider it completely useless. Because everything here in the material world they know is material. And anything material is temporary. So therefore, why strive so hard to attain something that's like a dream that's going to be over soon? So this is the intelligence of a great devotee. So we see here, we're very fortunate to have this narration by Sukadeva Goswami to this king who's inquiring. First is describing this chronological event of the different personalities, and then it comes to Ambarish Maharaj, and he goes, I want to hear about this person. He's a great devotee. So he's going on. So here, we're going to read in these chapters about how Maharaj Ambarish lived. Throughout his whole life, he followed the regulative principles. He spent his time performing great chanting sacrifices, bathing ceremonies for the deity, worshiped them with all pomp, beautiful dresses, flower garlands, and with great attention, he worshiped the Lord. And he also engaged the brahmanas who were free from material desires in glorifying the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So here he had a wonderful deity, very pompous deity worship. This is how he spent his days, is just absorbed in the Supreme Personality of Godhead. I don't know, let's see. Okay. This is what happens to Maharaj Ambarish for some reason. Let's get this started again here. Okay. It says I'm on, but now it dropped it again. Now it doesn't even show up. Did it turn off? No. Okay, let's see what we're on. Oh, it went to Prabhupada 5G. We found that one. So it's on Rukmini Dorkadis 5GH. So it's asking for a password. Do you want to enter it? No, this is for the network. No, it's not here for some reason. See, everything's temporary in the material world, even our presentation. I did. So this is a very interesting situation. This Maharaj is engaged in devotional service. He doesn't have any enemies. But situations change. Got it? Thank you, Archita. Save the day here. Okay, let's see what happens now. Okay, we're on. That's where we left off. And then we saw the deities, beautiful deities that he was worshiping. And so fortunate. But one day, this great sage, Durvasa Muni, approached his ashram. And Maharaj Ambarish was fasting. So he had to break his fast and to drink water because it was a certain time. But this yogi knew this. So he came back and realized that, and he's very easily angered, or very easily pleased, I think, but he's angered this time. And what he does is he takes a hair out of his hair, throws it down to the ground, and creates this fierce demon wanting to kill this great devotee, Maharaj Ambarish. And Maharaj Ambarish is such a devotee, not attached to anything, seeing everything as Krishna's. Seeing this situation is actually Krishna's mercy. So he doesn't even try to protect himself. He just says, okay, this is the time to go. Folds his hands, thinks of Krishna. But Krishna has a different idea. Because he is always engaged in loving devotional service. Nothing is considered impossible for a devotee. So even the name of the Supreme Lord is sufficient for liberation. What to speak of protection. So he's thinking of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and Krishna sends his personal weapon, his Sudarshan Chakra. It's the disc weapon of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And he sent it to destroy that demon, and in fact, it chased this great yogi Durvasa Muni all over the universe. He couldn't find any shelter anywhere. He was running and running, and still this Sudarshan Chakra was behind him, and he could feel the heat on his back. So eventually he goes to Lord Shiva, he goes to Lord Brahma, goes to all these great demigods. They can't protect him. In fact, he even goes to Vaikuntha, and he bows down before Lord Narayan and asks for protection. But Lord Narayan says that, actually, I can't protect you. I'm actually completely under the control of my devotees. And, you know, they're completely attached to me. They're completely in the core of my heart. And they're just satisfied by being engaged in my loving devotional service. So he instructed Durvasa Muni that it's best that you go to Maharaj Ambarish immediately and beg for forgiveness. And if he forgives you, then you can be protected. So that's what he does. He fell down and clasped Maharaj Ambarish's lotus feet. And then, you know, Ambarish Maharaj saw Durvasa attempting to offer him prayers and things, and he became kind of embarrassed. But then he was praying for mercy, you know, for his offense, and he thought, oh, there was no offense. And he began to have compassion for him, and he offered prayers, wonderful prayers, to the Sudarshan Chakra, and pacified the chakra. And so the chakra disappeared and he was protected. So this is one of the glories of Maharaj Ambarish. He's a very fortunate soul. He has everything in the entire planet, but yet he's not attached to it. But what is he attached to? He's renounced, but yet he's attached. He's attached to service at the lotus feet of Krishna. And because of that, he actually really has everything. He has a Supreme Lord as his master, as his Lord, as everything to him, and his protector. And we saw by this wonderful story, which we'll begin to hear very soon in this chapter. So now we're going to a different situation here. Here we see Draupadi. She was dragged by the demons. Draupadi is a very, very beautiful woman. Actually, she was born to bewilder the demons and to defeat the demons, along with her brother, Drishtadyumna, who was born to kill Drona. But she's so beautiful that for some reason, that beauty just bewildered demons like Dronacharya. As you can see, Dronacharya is showing Drona, or Duryodhana was showing his thigh because he's such a demon. He was actually very much attached to Draupadi. And because he couldn't have her, he just flipped out and became so envious towards the Pandavas even more than he was. But this is what happens when the demons, they want some opulence, whether it's beauty, whether it's wealth. Like we know, Duryodhana wanted the entire kingdom for himself. Compare this to Maharaj Ambarish. Here he wanted to enjoy the kingdom, and he wanted to get it by any means, whether virtuous or unvirtuous. And we know that he did so many unvirtuous things to try to take over the kingdom, take over the planet, to be the ruler, to be the enjoyer. And in fact, he wanted to take control of Draupadi. And so this is what happened, is that the demons are completely bewildered and they go mad. They go insane. And they do the most crazy things. And yet, because they're devotees of Krishna, being harassed by the demons, Krishna is always there to protect them. And he supplied unlimited cloth so that her modesty can be protected. And yet we see these great personalities like Bhishma and Drona, they didn't do anything. You know, so they were bewildered also. So this whole plan of the demons is about to be destroyed. And this is Krishna's plan, is to destroy the demoniac and make way for righteousness and virtue to go throughout the world. In fact, we have this huge battle, this battle of Kurukshetra. I mean, it's a bloody warfare, but yet we celebrate it. Every year we celebrate this Bhagavad Gita, the advent of the Gita, the words of Krishna that he gave in the middle of the battlefield, of how everything, in whatever situation you're in, you could use that for Krishna, if it's authorized by Krishna. So this is what's happening, so glorified that even throughout history, there's many carvings, you know, great architecture, you know, based on all the pastimes of Krishna, you know, in his different pastimes, even the warfare pastimes, which seem to be very ghastly. But yet, it's wonderful. Even Maitreya said in the third canto, he said a warrior, he's talking to Vidura, No, Maitreya is actually addressing Vidura, and he's saying, O warrior, the inquiry made by you is just befitting. A devotee, because it concerns the incarnation of the personality of Godhead, he is the source of liberation from the chain of birth and death for all those who are otherwise destined to die. And Srila Prabhupada mentions in the purport here that people may wonder about this mundane war topics, and about great kings and opulence and so many different things. But a devotee, I mean, he's not inclined to hear mundane things. But Prabhupada mentions in the purport here, the topics of the warfare in which the Lord engages do not concern the war of death, but the war against the chain of Maya, which obliges one to accept repeated birth and death. In other words, one who takes delight in hearing the war topics of the Lord is relieved from the chains of birth and death. Foolish people are suspicious of Krishna's taking part in the battle of Kurukshetra, not knowing that he's taking part in sure liberation for all those who are present in the battlefield. It is said by Bhishma Dev that all who were present in the battle of Kurukshetra attained their original spiritual existences after death. Therefore, hearing the war topics of the Lord is as good as any other devotional service. So just like tying in what Savas read this morning about how simply by hearing the Bhagavatam, it's like the sun, we're relieved of all impurities. So any topics related to Krishna and his devotees is purifying. So we have such a great opportunity. We're going to hear about Maharaj Ambarish. who is a great hero. And talking about heroes, we all know about the great hero of Arjuna's son. Anybody remember his name? Abhimanyu. He's a great warrior, and he was a hero. He utilized his life in the service of the Lord's mission. I mean, he knew how to penetrate the great Chakravyuha that Drona had created in order to capture King Yudhisthira. So he penetrated that. And he was asked by Yudhisthira to do this. And he admitted to Yudhisthira that, actually, I know how to penetrate it, but I do not know yet how to break out of it. But they said, don't worry, we'll follow you, we'll be close behind you, and we'll smash it apart so you'll be protected. So he was so enthusiastic that he just wanted to do that to please his authority, which was Maharaj Yudhisthira, his king, because they were on a mission to win this war for Krishna. They couldn't lose. So he even realized that this he could lose his life, but yet he was very enthusiastic. In fact, after they entered, this personality had a benediction from Lord Shiva. What was his name again? That was Jayadratha. He had a benediction that he could stand off the Pandavas for one day, but not Arjuna. But Arjuna was sent to another section of the battlefield, so he wasn't there. So they actually closed off Yudhisthira and Bhima and the Pandavas from protecting this boy warrior, Abhimanyu. So then, he realized he saw King Yudhisthira, and he knew that he was locked in there. But yet he used all his forces, all his enthusiasm, and he practically wiped out an entire Akshahini division of their warriors by himself. He was so great that no one could defeat him on a one-to-one basis. He sent Karna back. He sent Drona back. He injured them. Send them flying back. And the only way they could defeat him was that they had to break Dharma. They had to cheat. So all seven Maharatis attacked one Maharati. So they grabbed him from behind, you know, broke his bow, broke his shield, his chariot, his horses, killed. And then eventually he fought still without his weaponry, and just with the chariot wheel, he attacked them and was knocking them apart. And he said, he looked so beautiful, he looked just like Krishna when Krishna attacked Bhishma with the wheel of the chariot. So this is the heroes, the great fortunate personalities. They utilize everything, their energy for Krishna, to fight for Krishna, because it actually is a war that we're fighting. So we see here, as we described, he tore apart practically the entire Akshahini. Great battle ensued. And all this, you can see here, is where he's with the chariot wheel. And this is when they broke all the rules of even the Kshatriya rules of fighting, and they killed this boy. And then after Arjuna found out, he became very morose, and he actually lamented. And he was crying for his son. And one may think, this is what Arjuna was doing in the beginning of the battlefield. He was crying. He was lamenting because he didn't want to hurt his family members. But now he's lamenting again. So one scholar actually asked Srila Prabhupada, didn't Arjuna get the Bhagavad Gita? I mean, why is he lamenting for his son? And Srila Prabhupada explained that very nicely. He said, it's not that devotees don't lament or cry when there's things like that when your son dies. He said, it's natural. You have love for your son, and he's dead. You definitely have these emotions. But what made Arjuna transcendental is, even though despite of this great loss and his lamentation, he didn't give up the fight. In fact, he fought more enthusiastically than ever before. And this is where he actually made a vow to kill this Jayadratha before sunset. And here Krishna protected him and helped him keep that vow. It's a whole story, but we won't go into that. So we have here Maharaj Parikshit, who was born. In fact, when he first was born, he lost his body. He was killed. You know, it's almost like his mission was to die. That's his service, was to die. And so he came. He was born and Krishna protected him. And we're very fortunate that he did, because we have this great narration of the Srimad Bhagavatam between Sukadeva Goswami and Maharaj Parikshit. And this has been handed down from age to age, to spiritual master to spiritual master. And finally, we have it come to us in this particular day and age. And Srila Prabhupada, out of his compassion, his great mercy, he created ISKCON, and showing us how to remove impurities from the heart. And how do you remove those impurities? Is that you become pure. You become truthful. You follow Dharma. And this is what happens. So Prabhupada said, no matter what happens in the future, to never leave ISKCON. And how this movement should be based on love and trust. And how can you trust someone who's not truthful, who doesn't live according to Dharma? So this is what Prabhupada wanted to create, a society in which it's all based on love and trust, where actually people actually very deeply respected and loved each other. Not that, you know, we have to like use the trickery to get people to do things, like lie in order to get your service done or to get these things done. I mean, we have these ability. Sometimes a mother may say to the child that's about to die to take the medicine, but he won't take it. But she'll lie to him and say, no, this is candy, just take it, it's fine. But it's not that devotees take advantage of that and think that, oh, we could say anything just to get my way done or to do this so that I can get this done. But no, we have to actually develop love and trust. And Prabhupada said that's our movement is based on love and trust. So this is very important. Srila Prabhupada came to teach that. And you can imagine a society that is pure in mind, that's pure in body, that's pure in speech. It'd be like Vaikuntha men, Vaikuntha ladies. Imagine the potency. And that's the potency that's needed to convince the conditioned souls to take up Krishna consciousness and to convert the entire world into Krishna consciousness. This is our process. And this is what the gifts of His Divine Grace, Srila Prabhupada, has given us. The opportunity to actually become pure, to follow Dharma. And these gifts we can take advantage of. We can just dive into them, and there's nectar at every step. Srila Prabhupada has given us these Vedic literatures. He's given us his most beautiful deities that we can worship. This is actually the Supreme Personality of Godhead that we're in association with. And by taking advantage of these, we will actually become pure. And we'll realize that the only important thing in this world is actually our service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Just like Maharaj Ambarish. He worshipped the deity so nicely. He respected the brahmanas. He served Krishna. And that was his only goal and wealth in life. So we're very grateful to Srila Prabhupada, who's came and given us this transcendental sound vibration of his wonderful bhajans, lectures, letters, instructions, like this in so many different ways. So we are very fortunate. And we are most fortunate, actually. It's not fortunate that we have great wealth, but we have great knowledge, great light, great wisdom, given by the great devotees who are filled with this wisdom and knowledge and purity. So thank you very much. If there's any comments or questions? There's so much going on today that devotees are taking advantage of Prabhupada's gifts. Just as we know, there's the Acharya film that's coming out. They're using so many nice technology to create films about Srila Prabhupada and what he did. And my son was just telling me how there's a couple in New York who's going to make like a continuation of that, but it's a separate film of the devotees, of how Prabhupada, what he set up and what the devotees are doing now, you know, in ISKCON, what they're doing. And if anybody wants to stay, I have a little clip of a video that Mari just created. My son just sent me a link this morning. And it shows how the devotees are taking advantage of what Prabhupada has given us and teaching it to our children how to love Radha Krishna. This is our whole goal in life. So our children are actually doing it, training our children to show this and to enact pastimes with Krishna and to bring out the importance of people, the land of Krishna, Vrindavan, and what devotees are doing to protect that place. So I'll play it now with your permission, if anyone would like to stay. Otherwise, people can leave, or if you have a question, comment, yes.
How from a person who is under the three modes of material nature, like in this case, Durvasa Muni, full of anger, ends up being in the Vaikunthas?
He had a great... I'll send it to you. Okay. The question was that this great yogi, Durvasa Muni, he was under the modes of nature. How could he enter Vaikuntha?
Full of anger.
Full of anger. And yeah, he became very angry easily. Well, it's described that he had such great mystic power and that he could do these things. He was actually like a part of Lord Shiva, right? Wasn't he? Like an incarnation of Lord, part of Lord Shiva. But yet, this Vaikuntha is another Vaikuntha that's within the material world, isn't it? It's not like Vaikuntha, but it's like a replica of that in the material world where he was able to go. But this is the power of great devotees, great yogis, I mean. They can travel at will anywhere, do so many different things. But you have this great power, but yet still, he wasn't able to get protected even when he went to Vaikuntha. And how did he get protected? By getting the mercy of a devotee. This is so important, is that we get the mercy of the devotee. So we're fortunate to have the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. So, thank you, Prabhu. Any other comments, questions? Okay, let me just see if this is what will happen here, if I hit this. Yeah, it's not gonna... Oh, yeah, I can do this.
Radhe, Radhe Govinda, Radhe.
Enacting the pastimes of Krishna.
Secret. Radhe Govinda.
Govinda Radhe Radhe.
Radhe Govinda.
Bhakti without borders. Jai. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Goes through my Bhagavatam. Srila Prabhupada.